Okay, everybody, welcome. My name is Andrew King, Managing Director at WebSAN Solutions, and today we're going to talk about manufacturing capacity planning in Dynamics NAV. So this is part five of a series that we've been doing for a while now. And capacity planning isn't a huge module in Dynamics NAV, but it's definitely got a lot of good features that I think is worth going through. So before we jump into that, I want to talk a little bit about us. We've been in business 17 years, pretty much sell everything Microsoft except Dynamics AX from an ERP perspective, Dynamics 365 Sales, which is CRM, Field Service, NAV, obviously, Dynamics 365 Financials, and Dynamics GP. Clients all over the world. Definitely want to call your attention to a couple things. One, our YouTube channel. We've got about 340,000 views of all our different videos up there. This video is going to go up on the web probably tomorrow or so, but definitely some good content out there I highly recommend you taking a look at. We also have our WebSAN University website where we have some paid courses that are a little more in-depth on the various solutions that we sell. So today, like I said, we're going to dive into capacity planning. If you haven't seen the other sections, I highly encourage you to do so. They're a bit of a foundation for today's session as we get into more advanced topics, and a couple more sessions to go after this. So some good stuff out there. This is just my overview slide of manufacturing and Dynamics NAV. The only thing I really want to call your attention to is over here, really when you're booking labor, when you're booking machine time, when your routing contains labor, when your routing contains machine time, that's what's called a capacity journal. So what the system is really doing is taking up capacity in the work center on a finite basis, and the scheduling is based on the calendar and the size of the work center, et cetera. When we charge labor or machine time, more commonly labor, to the work order or production order, then that data comes from the work center as far as the dollars and units and things like that. And that's what we're going to show you today. So speaking of today's agenda, I want to walk you through first the setup of a work center, how you do it, what it looks like, how you set up calendars and available time, and different variables that are part of the work center setup that you really need to be aware of. Want to talk as well about how load from the production orders is allocated to the work centers. We'll go take a look at a routing and look through that. And then we'll talk again about capacity and how that's really working when you have released production orders. We'll talk about how you move capacity loads from one resource to the other. That really gets into this hierarchy of machine centers, and we'll talk a little bit about that. And then how to then affect those changes in your production orders. And we'll dive into a little bit of reporting and statistics with respect to work centers, utilizations, and efficiencies. All right, so without further ado, let's dive in there. Here I am in Dynamics NAV. Today I'm logged in as a shop supervisor with all access to the manufacturing module. And the first thing I want to look at is let's just dive right into work centers. I've got a really simple one here, created a quality assurance work center. So let's go into that. The first thing I want to show you is obviously there's a name of the work center, things like that, but there's also a work center group code. And what that means is from a hierarchy of capacity, I can look at capacity at the group level, I can look at it at a work center level, and then finally I can look at it at the actual machine level. So we're assigning QA to a particular group of work centers. If you think about this in a shop, you know, maybe you've got like equipment that for whatever reason you want to have in different work centers. Maybe they're in physically different rooms, but when it comes to efficiency and analysis, you want to look at them all together. So if you're in the woodworking industry or wood cutting industry, you might have different mills. They might be in different facilities or different parts of the same facility, but I still want to look at them together because they're similar equipment, okay? The other piece is when you get into the costing and posting section, number one, you've definitely got unit costs. You can capture unit costs by time or by units, depending on how you want to do it. We just discussed this in an outsourcing webinar that we did, and obviously for outsourcing, you're probably getting charged more units rather than time, but internally, with internal resources, you're probably getting charged time. department code, project code, subcontractor code for outsourcing. These are all things that can be used for reporting, things like that. Flushing method manual. This just says whether I'm going to backflush the labor or associated charges in this work center. And then the general product posting group tells the system where to put the money in the general ledger if I am actually charging something through this work center, whether it be labor or machine time.